presence washes over. Your 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 presence washes. Washes over me. Washes over me. Washes over.
Living Springs, would you rise and prepare to sing with us?
Just invest this time right now into focusing on God. Focus your eyes on Him in this moment. Lord, tell us what you're doing right now. Tell us what you're doing right now, Father. Lord, we wait on you. Lord, we wait on you. We're grateful, Lord, we worship you. Lord, we worship you. We wait on your presence, Jesus. And we invest our mind, we invest our focus on you. We invest our energy on you. Atmosphere changes when you walk into the room. The atmosphere changes when you walk into the room. Atmosphere is changing now. Atmosphere. evidence is all. The evidence is all.
With your love, your love surrounds us. You're the reason we came to encounter your love, 'cause your love surrounds us. Atmosphere is changing now, for the Spirit of the Lord is here. The evidence is all around,
Spirit of the Lord,
that the Spirit of the Lord. Atmosphere is changing now,
for the Spirit of,
for the Spirit of the Lord is here.
Evidence is all.
The evidence is all around, that the Spirit of the Lord. With your love surrounds us. You're the reason we came to encounter your love, 'cause your love surrounds us. Overflowing this place. Fill our hearts with your love surrounds us. You're the reason we came to encounter your love, 'cause your love surrounds us.
Your love surrounds us. Your love, your love. Sing your love, your love. Your love, your love. Your love, your love. Surround us. Surround us. Spirit of God, fall fast.
Fall fresh on us. We need your presence. Your kingdom come. Your will be done here as in heaven. kingdom come, your will be done here as in heaven. Spirit of God, fall fresh on us. We need your presence. Your kingdom come, your will be done here as in heaven.
Last time, sing Spirit of God. Spirit of God.
Spirit of God. Fall fresh on us. We need your presence. Your kingdom come. Your will be done here as in heaven.
Spirit.
Spirit. Fresh on us, we need your presence.
We need your presence right now. We need
your kingdom come.
Your will be
done here as in heaven.
Spirit of God, fall fresh.
Fall fresh on us, 'cause we need your presence.
Your presence, we need
Jesus, your kingdom come. It's your will to be done here as in heaven.
Miracle can happen now. The Spirit of the Lord is here.
Evidence is all around.
For the Spirit of
that the Spirit of the Lord is here.
Miracle can happen.
Miracle can happen now.
For
the Spirit of the Lord is here.
Feel His presence.
The evidence is all around.
Right here, right here.
That the Spirit of the Lord is here.
The evidence.
The evidence is all around.
At the Spirit of
the Spirit of the Lord is here.
The Spirit of the Lord.
promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Wait.
worker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. It's my God. That is who you are. Miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are.
God, we're so grateful that you are a way maker, that you are a miracle worker. We thank you, God, that those are not just words, but those are actions, those are activities that you are engaged in. You're in the process of changing us and transforming us and healing us and working in us. And Lord God, we avail ourselves to what you would do in our hearts, in our minds today. God, we're grateful for this Thanksgiving weekend, and we just acknowledge that we have so much to be thankful for. Let's use the words of Psalm 100 just to give the Lord thanks. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good and his love endures forever, and his faithfulness continues through all generations. Let's lift it up now. Let's lift up his name. Let's shout. Let's make a shout to the Lord. There are so many reasons, even this weekend, time to celebrate, time to feast, time to enjoy your good gifts. Let's take a moment even now to lift up thanks. And in this place, let's do it unashamedly. If there's anything that you're thankful for, we're just going to say, Lord, we praise you for. Lord, we thank you for. So let's just make that offering to him right now. So, Lord, I thank you for it. Just lift it up, even as you think of things that God has blessed you with, or just words of who he is. Mm-hmm. What are you thankful for? Lord, I praise you for, or I thank you for.
Thank you for worship.
Thank you for your faithfulness. Yes. Thank you for your provision. Stops. Never stops. Now the psalm commands us to shout to the Lord. Now from the gut, everything within us. Let's give a holy shout unto the Lord and lift up his praises together as a concert of praise. Are you ready? Let's go. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Yes. God, we give you thanks. We give you praise. Hallelujah. You're good. Slowly pray the Lord's Prayer together. It's the prayer that the Lord taught us to pray. Together slowly. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen, amen, amen. Let's give thanks. Good to worship with you, saints. Let's take a moment to greet each other, give each other a fist pump or an elbow bump or something, and say hey, and bless somebody. And the kids will also dismiss to their children's church. Find your seat. Well, gang, not only is this Thanksgiving weekend, but it is the beginning of the season of Advent. And Advent is a season of preparation and anticipation of the coming of Christ. And it's not just a time to buy presents and decorate trees and so on. It's a time to prepare our hearts for the coming of Jesus. And it's a blessed season to do that and to enjoy his presence. So we're going to do that. And we're going to, traditions that we have at the church is the lighting of the Advent candles. And each one of these candles has a meaning. And you're going to hear about that every Sunday during Advent until Christmas Eve. And this morning, the Cordero family is going to lead us in the lighting of our first Advent candle.
This is the first Sunday in Advent. Today we light one purple candle. This is the candle of hope. Advent is a time of waiting and hoping. We wait for the day when we celebrate again the birth of Jesus. We hope that everyone will come to know God and to worship him.
When we look at the first candle, we remember God's promise. God promised to send a Savior to the people. When we listen to our scripture reading, we hear what the prophet Isaiah wrote about God. God is the potter who molds us. We know that the gospel witness is one that helps us understand that God is loving and just. God brings us peace. This gives us hope. We anticipate again the birth of the baby, Jesus, remembering that Jesus helps us know God's love for us.
Isaiah 64:8 says, "Yet, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay. You are the potter. We are all the work of your hand."
Think about a potter. A potter takes clay and forms it in a way that is pleasing. That is what God is able to do with each person. We are reminded that we are all the work of God's hands.
Let us pray together. Dear God, thank you for your son, Jesus. Thank you for the words of the prophet Isaiah that remind us that you are the source of our hope. Help us to live each day, allowing you to form us in a way that brings about your kingdom here on earth. Amen. Welcome, everybody. I want to welcome you to Living Springs. It's a joy to be with you and to enjoy the presence of the Lord with you. So welcome, everybody. I want to welcome those who are joining us here in person and those who are joining us online and at other times. It is a joy to be with you. So a couple things to pass along to us. First of all, if you could grab those welcome cards that are around you, and please take a moment to fill those out. And if you could take a moment to, if there's prayer requests or needs that you have, or praises, we'd love to praise God with you. And also, if there's needs, we want to know about that so we can pray for you or meet those needs. So let's know about that. Also, if you're a first-time guest with us today, special welcome to you. We're honored to have you with us. It's a joy to have you with us. And if you take those welcome cards to the Welcome Center, they have a nice gift for you there at the Welcome Center, so make sure you do that. And then a couple things to pass along to us. First of all, I want to just encourage us. Worship is a full contact sport. Well, not really. We shouldn't probably hit one another like in football. But, you might watch a football game this afternoon, but worship is not something we watch. Worship is something that we engage in. And we come to Jesus and bring him our praise, and we receive all that he has for us. And it's in that engagement that we encounter the living God. And he meets us and ministers to us and heals us and delivers us and encourages us. And so that's what worship is, and that's why we worship him. So I want to encourage us to worship him with all of our heart. And that includes when we hear his word, that we're open and receptive. Amen? All right. So a couple of quick things to pass along. Next weekend is a very important weekend. We are doing all kinds of stuff, including we're always looking for ways to bless our community and beyond. That's our vision, right? To radically bless our community and beyond. One of the ways that we do that is something through our Circle Ministry. Circle Ministry ministers to people that are underserved in this neighborhood and also in Riverdale, where our sister church is. Living Springs, Riverdale, and we're collecting right now coats and gifts, and if you have received those, make sure you bring them by next Sunday. That's when those are due, so make sure you bring that. And then, parents and kids, there's some great stuff going on next weekend. First of all, on Saturday, we are having pictures. So you can come with yourself or your family or whoever you'd like, and whatever you'd like to wear on Christmas, whether it's your dressing up or your ugly sweaters or your pajamas if you want to. Come and we take some pictures. That's fun on December 4. You can actually sign up, reserve your time online for that on our website. Also, on next Sunday, following the service, we have a fun thing for folks, and that is a cookie decorating party for kids and families. You can just come right after service. We're going to be decorating cookies, have hot chocolate. Great time to connect with some other great families here at Living Springs. So you can look forward to that. And now I'd like to ask if the ushers would come for this morning's offering. And you know what the book of Malachi says? It says, bring the whole tithe into the storehouse and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that you don't have room for it. And so there's blessing that comes. As we give, God also blesses us in return. And so we have a great opportunity to not only care for the needs of folks in this church, in our community, but to the ends of the earth. So let's give with gladness. Let's pray together. God, it's our joy to come to you today and worship you and to give you our praise and now to give you these gifts and tithes and offerings. And we ask that they would be used to magnify and glorify your name in this community and beyond. And we love you and we look forward to what you're going to do in our hearts as your word is shared, and we open our hearts to receive it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Gathered at the highest throne, welcomed by a melody, an anthem I have always known, a song that's always been in me. All glory and honor, dominion and power to you. A million angels fall, face down on the floor, all to echo, holy is the Lord. My heart can't help but sing with all of heaven.
Was a dream. And the dream was God's hope, and God was hope. Spoke his imagination to a world that only knew void and translated it into everything that is here now. That hope has come again. In the midst of despair and nightmares, God's dream for our lives has come true. This hope that turns a trough into a throne, as creator steps into creation and the ruler becomes a servant. This hope that makes a map out of stars, leads wise men to the place where God is doing the miraculous. This hope that declares that distance has become near, that the Lord's promise is finally here at last, Emmanuel. With man, he dwells in and among us, just as God had always dreamed it would be since the beginning. In the beginning, when he chose to love us even after we chose another, he promised that a chosen one would come and choose to take on flesh, choose to take on death, and lay down his life to pay the price for all of our poor choices. Like where we place our hopes. Mine are often more Christmas than they are Advent, more focused on stuff or things than it is nativity. We place our longings in lifeless objects and hope that wrapping them in our affection will somehow turn them to gifts. We've gotten too good at decorating dead trees, but our God has sown a seed in the hopes that we might be rooted in his dream for our lives. This hope that turned shepherds into watchmen, that those who had gone unnoticed would be the first to bear witness to the good news. This hope that turns doubters into dreamers. For just as God's spirit had moved in Mary's womb and also on the canvas of Joseph's mind, our God has coated many colors on his paintbrush to paint his imagination on the backs of our eyelids. See now. That hope has come again, that God's dream has once more invaded our sleeping world to transform our unexpecting hearts through the miracle of an expecting virgin. How else could we hope for tomorrow unless a son be given to us? And he has. Hope has come, and hope is yet coming. May we all prepare to receive the coming of what we truly need. May we prepare to receive this dream and the hope that it brings. May we prepare to receive the coming of our King, the coming of our hope.
I am excited to share with you as we go into this season of Advent, which always begs the question, why talk about Advent, right? Mainly because many of us have this attitude that we've been there, done that, that we already know how the story goes, right? We all could probably quote the story of how Jesus came and was set into a trough in the stable, right? And we think we know it. And I just want to tell us at the beginning of the beginning, as we go in through the story of Advent, that been there, done that attitude with Scripture will get us into huge trouble and cause us to miss out on the fullness of what God has for us. Just to be clear, the spirit of revelation is a beautiful thing because it's God coming and revealing new things to us, even though we read the story again and again and again. And it's my prayer as we go into this Christmas and we hear the story of all stories that we can go in with excitement because God just might reveal to us something we haven't seen before, something that we haven't heard before. Amen? Amen. Well, let's do that together. We are going to be going through for the next 4 Sundays, going through the different words of Advent. All right? We're going through hope, joy, love, and peace. And we are starting today with hope. Originally, my message was called Foundations of Hope, but I changed the title. Here's why. About a week and a half ago, I was writing this message. God kind of put it on my heart late at night, and I was up till 3 a.m. And I got this message done underneath the leading of the guiding of the Holy Spirit and got it onto a USB drive, and then I promptly cleaned my computer. I took that USB drive and stuck it in my pocket so that there would be no issue with losing this USB drive. However, I ended up going to a conference with the EDS, the student leaders. And when I got to that conference, or when we came back from the conference, I ended up being involved in rescuing a little lost dog. I know it's a totally weird story. I'm not going to give you the whole thing. No, I'm not telling you. There's this crazy moment where I had to get this dog in and out of my car and then call a lost lady, and she had to come find this dog and whatever. But in the process, something happened. I dropped my USB. On Monday, I went in to finish up my PowerPoint, and I'm good to go, and it's 4 p.m., and I still can't find my USB. I went home, searched the pants, the jackets. You all know how this goes, right? Got nothing. I'm going to have to rewrite this message. God help me. I got to get it done by the end of tonight. Praise God. One of my students was out walking, picks up a USB drive, and says, "Is this yours?" Finds it in the grass. And so the Lord gives me my message on hope, and I'm calling this message Hope Found because it was literally found. It's good to start on this topic of hope because, in all reality, if you are hopeless, you're not going to be able to love well. If you are hopeless, you're not going to have joy. If you are hopeless, you're not going to go ahead and have peace. So it is a good foundation for us to start with as we go in this morning. Now, quickly, I want to say some things about hope because what our culture and what kind of the Americans really kind of believe about hope is really they treat hope more like a wish, right? That it's just some kind of wish that we throw out there. I remember I had a friend who had to pray at his brother's wedding, and he didn't have a background really in the faith, but he was given the role to pray. So that was always fun. So he gets up there, and basically this was his prayer. God, I hope everyone has a good time, and I hope everyone enjoys their food, and I hope that this marriage lasts, and I hope it is a wonderful day. Amen. Okay. Like, all right, the difference between that kind of hope, where it's just a shot in the dark wish, with biblical hope, is biblical hope, and I've said this before, is the joyful anticipation of good. Biblical hope is the joyful anticipation of good. It is something that we can expect. It is about having joy even before the breakthrough happens that we're waiting for. All right, now here's the difficulty. We all know that it's easy for us to have joy when the breakthrough happens, right? Like last year, I was struggling a little bit financially, and I got a phone call from a whole bunch of strangers that the Mix radio show just called my name, and if I call in, I get $1,000, and I called in, and I got my $1,000 check. It was easy to celebrate when I got that. It was not easy to celebrate when we are in the midst of the, before the promise gets the breakthrough, we are sitting in that place of waiting. It's much more difficult. But that's the way we're called to live. That's the kind of hope we are supposed to have. Why? Because it is actually rooted in the nature of who our God is. We can trust him. He has proven himself trustworthy time and time and time again. And so because of his nature, we can celebrate now before the breakthrough even happens. I just want to remind us, it doesn't, you know, we don't always know what's going to happen. We can't know what's going to happen. But we can trust in this, that our God is the God of breakthrough, and he will answer. Now, I'm not talking about a phony faith or a phony hope. You know, I don't really like buying into that fake kind of hope where people are like, we just don't even announce that we have a problem. You know what I'm talking about? Where it's just like, you know, oh, there's no problems. It's everything's good. Praise God. No, I'm not talking about that. I believe that real hope and faith isn't about denying the existence of a problem. It's simply about denying that problem the supremacy in our minds and in our hearts, all right? So that doesn't mean we don't ignore the past due bill. We don't ignore the bad medical report. We don't ignore the relationship that's crumbling, right? But we do trust that our God is a God of breakthrough, and he will bring provision and answers for every issue we have. So we've seen it from the beginning until now, and I just want to give us a short picture of the Bible. I mean, God creates in Genesis, right? And then the garden is beautiful and everything's going good, and then it crumbles because they had to go and eat the fruit, right? And then God raises up and calls forth a people eventually, and then there's an exodus. He leads them out and saves them, and then the people rebel again, and then God, they're all like, God, send us kings, and he's like, okay, we'll give you some kings, and then they all rebel again, and then God's like, hey, I got an answer for you. I'm going to send you some prophets who are going to come and speak forth an answer, and in this season, we always quote one of them, Isaiah. Verse 7 and 14, therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel. Now that's a beautiful scripture we read, but how many know that that promise didn't get fulfilled right away? Do you know there were 400 years of silence where nothing, it seemed, was happening? See, when God gives the promise, sometimes there's a process of waiting, but eventually God breaks in. Luke 1, and we'll go ahead and read that. Got that up there? In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to the man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." So we go into this Christmas season. This is the story. And this is the place it begins. But like I said, there were 400 years of silence. It was a long process of waiting. But here's the deal. We sang this song this morning, Waymaker. And those verses, even when I don't see it, he's working. Even when I don't feel it, he's working. He never stops working, right? Oh, you're going to get me singing. Listen, our God was working even in that 400 years of silence. There was something he was preparing the people for. And so I want to tell you, in that season between the promise and the breakthrough, God is always working. You can trust that. I promise you that. In the beginning, God even gave a message of hope, and he prophesied of this very verse that would come forth when Jesus would come to earth in the incarnation of God becoming man. Do you know that God prophesied it to the serpent in the garden? What did he say? That little girl that you tricked over there, paraphrase. That little girl that you tricked over there, Satan, out of her bloodline, I will bring forth one who you will strike his heel, but he will crush your skull. That was a word given about the prophecy of that day when Jesus would be born. It was promised from the very beginning. But God has been working. I want to jump in to our meaty verse of today from Romans 8, verse 18 through 30. And I'm going to break it down as we go. I meant to put some little lines in here so I know, so excuse me if I go a little bit backwards, but I'm just going to try my best. Here we go. I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. For the creation waits in eager expectation for the children of God to be revealed. For the creation was subjected to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself would be liberated from its bondage to decay and brought into the freedom and glory of the children of God. Now here you see the yearning of all creation, right? To be set free from the bondage to decay and to have a yearning for eternity. We were made to dwell with God. We were made to connect with God. This is the yearning of all creation. We know that the whole creation has been groaning as in the pains of childbirth right up to the present time. Not only so, but we ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for our adoption to sonship, the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope we were saved. But hope that is seen is no hope at all. Who hopes for what they already have? But if we hope for what we do not yet have, we wait for it patiently. Now this is what I'm talking about. The reality of being able to wait for something patiently. The only way we're patient is when we know that God is going to come and bring the breakthrough. Okay? Listen, because that thing with patience, you tell a kid, right? Like, have you seen those videos that they have? These are kind of funny. Where they put the little candy out and say, don't eat that candy until I get back. You watch and the kid's like, and all they have to do is wait patiently and they get the candy. But most of them start sneaking it in their mouths because it's what kids do. Wait patiently. Waiting patiently is about having hope and the anticipation of good. Listen, every kid, for the most part, wakes up on Christmas morning with presents downstairs. And what is their anticipation? Do you think they have this attitude like, oh. No, they're pretty sure there's going to be something good. I mean, unless their mom always gives them socks. Right? But there is this anticipation of good. They have this expectancy. It's what causes kids to not be able to go to sleep on Christmas Eve. I've learned to sleep on Christmas Eve. Amen. The verse goes on. In the same way, now this is beautiful. In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. Listen to this. This is beautiful. We don't know what to do in our seasons of waiting. We don't know what to do in that process. But the good news is our God knows what we need. And the Spirit inside of us groans and calls out to God for that very thing we need. So that when we think we need one thing and the Spirit actually knows we need the other, the Spirit will groan for us and get us connected with the whole with God and what we need, actually. See, it's like you know, my prayer. God, I need a Lamborghini. And then the Holy Spirit's like, he needs to get to work, God. Send him a Hyundai. Thank God for the Hyundai. Now, 28 and 29, this is where I want us to sit with today. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. Why is this verse in the Bible? It's because there is always going to be space. There's always going to be space between the promise and the breakthrough. And in that space, God knows that it is difficult for us. How many of you guys have waited for something and struggled in that place of waiting? I think it was Bishop Garlington. He said it's like a house. It's like rooms in a house. It's glory to glory, but there's hell in the hallway. Okay? We all know that getting from one room to the next can be a little difficult. And it's a struggle. And sometimes we hear these promises and we go, God, I need a breakthrough. I need you to show me. I remember when I was in college. This is funny. I wasn't going to share this. When I was in college, everybody was, you know, at the dance and found their girl. And I was like, oh, I want to find my wife. So I started trying to bargain with the Lord. I was like, Lord, if you just introduce me to my wife and I could like have a dance with her, she could like go away for 10 years. But it'd be good because then I could just know she exists. Right? Some of y'all could relate to that. There's a space of waiting, but this is the good news, that in all things, God is working things for the good of those who believe. He is working them. And in verse 29, it really shows us a key, and it's what Dave even prayed this morning. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. Listen, the process of waiting is about conforming us to the image of his Son. I want you guys to catch that this morning. The processes of waiting, God is conforming us. He is working something. Why? Because we won't be able to receive the fullness of the promise if we are not conformed to the image of Christ. God wants to transform our hearts to make us look more like Jesus. The processes of life. Look, listen, we might be able to know, like, okay, this is God's heart. God is a God of breakthrough. He is a healer. He is a way maker, right? He is the light in the darkness. He is all of those things. But we don't know the process he's going to take us through to get to there, to where we can actually receive the fullness of it. There's a process. There's a journey, right? We've all heard that little phrase. It's not about the destination, but about the journey. God is creating something in us, and it is beautiful. This Advent season, we light these candles. It's something we do all the time, and the lighting of the candle of even this first one is about hope. And it's true, Jesus himself laid it out before us what hope looks like. He did it in the story in John chapter 3, talking to Nicodemus. And I'm going to go ahead and share that with us in verse 14. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light so that it may be seen plainly that what they have done has been done in the sight of God. Our God came not to condemn the world, but to lay his life down for the world. He came as a light in the midst of darkness, he said with his own words. But the people who wanted to dwell in darkness would reject the light, because it's harder to live in the light. It's harder to live exposed. But those who want to live in the light, who want to live in that place, will have a hope that is contagious. Did you know, as Christians, we're supposed to have a hope that is contagious to the world? How many of us are struggling with hope? Really, how many of us struggle with hope? We have these little problems come to us, and You know, they seem so big. Many of us could look back on those problems that we had, right? And some of those ones that we were most worried about. And on the other side, you're like, well, those weren't big at all. But in the moment, they seem so hard, right? They seem so difficult. And we never remember what we learned there in our current issue. We always just kind of leave that one behind. And like, oh, you know, God was faithful then, but this one's different. Guys, God is faithful. His nature is good. He is a healer. He is the one who will break through. He is Jehovah Jireh, God the provider. He is Jehovah Rapha, God the healer. He is Jehovah Nisi, God our banner, who will be a banner over you in all your relationships. He is a good God, and we can trust him. I promise you we can trust him. As we are in this season where we are hoping, where we are yearning to live in a season of hope, I promise you, it's in looking at God as your hope that you will find your answer. And in nothing else. What do we hope in? What are some of the things we hope in besides God? Some of us hope in our paychecks. Some of us hope in our retirement. Some of us are living and hoping for our next vacation. Some of us are hoping for that future wife. That will solve everything. Some of you are hoping, never mind, I'm not going to follow that one up. Some of you found out that's not true. Some of you are hoping for kids. Some of you hoping for the kids to get out of the house. But we trust in God. It says in Psalms, some trust in chariots, some trust in horses. But we will trust in the name of our God. Listen, there are mighty things out there. There are great things, and we might put our hope in all of those things because they make us feel good. But ultimately, God isn't interested in the American dream as we see it. God isn't interested in the American dream as we see it. Listen, we have to stop holding God hostage. A lot of us, we struggle with this because we think that if God is a God of miracles, then he's going to give me this miracle this way. Or if God is a God of provision, then I'm going to wake up tomorrow and there's going to be an envelope with money in it. And we hold God to this hostage standard. God isn't our hostage, y'all. God wants to bring forth something beautiful in us. And you can trust how he is and how good he is. But that process, we might not be willing to go through. But we need to. Because the process is forming us into Christ. I want to read to you a quote Bill Johnson has written that I always love. It says this, in any area of your life in which you lack a joyful anticipation of good as the outcome, you are under the influence of a lie. I want you to think about those scenarios right now that we struggle with, whatever those personal ones are for you. In any area that you are lacking a joyful anticipation of good as the outcome for that situation, we are under the influence of a lie. God wants to break every lie that keeps us from the truth that he is a good God, that he is a way maker, that he is a miracle worker, that he is a promise keeper, that he is the light in the midst of darkness. He is our hope. He is our hope. Reason we read John 3 this morning, I shared this on Facebook not so long ago. Some of you saw it. Pretty cool thing happened the other week. On a late Saturday night, I had one of my PlayStation kids reach out to me, a different one than normal. And he was like, hey, am I going to heaven or hell? And I was like, well, I know where I'm going. I hope that you would one day know where you're going. He was like, well, what do I got to do? I was like, listen, it's not about a simple prayer. It's about laying your life down before Jesus. It's about giving him your life in fullness. Not just a little bit where you say it so you don't, you know, God isn't waving people over hell by a rotten stick, right? And so I talked to him. He's like, I want to get in the Word with you. Can we get in the Word? And it's like 12:30 at night, and I'm an old man now. So, so I'm like, I'm going to bed, but tomorrow morning. So last Sunday, I finished church, and I got home, and we read the first three chapters of John. And we have a commitment to read all through John, all this week and into next week. And a beautiful thing happened. I mean, it actually wasn't beautiful. It was ugly, but God was in it. We get to John 3, and as we're reading John 3, I know where we're going to end up, right? We're going to end up reading exactly what we just read, that God came into the world not because he wanted to condemn the world, but because he loved the world, that if you give your life to him, you'll be with him forever in eternal life. And I get to that part, and we're talking about it, and right then he gets a call from his mom that she's getting robbed at knife point. And he's a 17-year-old kid, and obviously was scared and had to get off with me. But right then, I know that this happened. The devil overplayed his hand. Because when the devil comes so strong to bring fight to you, right when you're in the midst of giving your life to Jesus, you can go ahead and trust that God's got something bigger that the devil's trying to attack. Some of you guys have the enemy attacking you in a particular area over and over and over again. And I want to tell you, the devil's overplaying his hand. Flip it around, because God's about to bring breakthrough. Listen, the line between breakdown and breakthrough is really small. It's really thin. And you might feel like you're on the edge of a breakdown, but there's breakthrough coming if we can put our hope in him. I'm believing for hope for this kid and for his mom. And the reason we can hope is because our God is the God of breakthrough for all time. He did not just help us. He became us, y'all. He didn't just help us, he became us. He came down from the throne room of heaven and put on human skin, wrapped himself in skin as a garment, gave up light as a garment, and came into the incarnation of human flesh. He became us to give us hope. And he didn't just become us. He actually lived a life of demonstration for us of what it looks like to talk to God, to live a holy life, to go after him. It was God expressing himself through the face of Jesus to all of mankind. It's beautiful. Guys, God came to give us hope. And not just that, he died our death for us. Right? He paid the price that though the Satan would come and strike his heel, he would crush the serpent's skull. He would go forth and he would die the death. Listen, he owed us nothing. We deserved hell. But he gave us mercy. He died up on Calvary so that he can give us hope. But not just that. Not just that he would die, but that he would rise again, conquering death for all of us. He conquered death. He was the firstborn from the grave. He conquered it so that we can be with him. But that's the good news, actually. He didn't just conquer death. Listen, he didn't just come as us. He didn't just demonstrate for us. He didn't just die our death, but he rose again. But not just did he rise again, he ascended to heaven to prepare a place for us. Listen, it was his prayer in John 17 that we got. He said, Father, I desire that they would be with me where I am, yoked to me, locked to me, that I would be in him and he would be in me, and that we together would be made perfect in one. Listen, God's desire was that we would be with him forever in eternity. And he made a way. Listen, when you feel hopeless, God made a way for you to dwell with him in eternity forever. Forever. And not just that, but then he would send the good one, the comforter, the Spirit, to come for us, to live inside of us, to yearn and groan for the things that we need, even in our moments when we feel we're in crisis. But wait, there's more. Not only did he go to create a place for us, but one day those clouds are going to rip open, and what goes up must come down. And when Jesus comes down, he is going to come back as the Lion of the tribe of Judah. Not just the baby in a manger, not just the little broken man on the cross, the lamb led to the slaughter, but a Lion of the tribe of Judah. And he will come make the wrong things right. Every injustice will be brought to nothing. And in Psalms 2, it says that the kings of the earth will tremble and shake. They will bow down and kiss the Son or receive his wrath. And God's going to come and he will make the wrong things right, y'all. He is coming and every eye will see him. Every knee will bow and every tongue confess that our Jesus Christ is our Lord forever. Listen, don't tell me you don't have hope. Don't tell me you don't have hope. There is a hope greater than every situation you find yourself in right this second. there is a hope. And the good news is this, even though we remember the birth, right? We're still looking forward to Jesus coming back and tearing open the clouds like a scroll. And when he comes back, he's going to break in and it's going to be powerful, y'all. It's everything we wanted. It's the story of all stories. We get to be in the story of all stories. You think the Lord of the Rings is a great story? It's got nothing. It was only made as a mimic of what Jesus was doing anyway and going to do on the earth. You are caught up in the story. This is the great news, y'all. See, when you're in those situations when it seems dark, you can say, I know the end of the story, and this is not the end of the story. Say it to your problem. Say it to your crisis. This isn't the end of my story. God's going to break through. He's going to break in, and he's going to answer. But I'm getting ahead of myself because we're just at the place where Jesus is born. Let's go ahead and stand. Listen, y'all, I wanted to do a message where we'd navigate through all the crises and God's answer to each of those and being the way maker. But the reality is this, there's such a bigger story. There's a bigger story that God has demonstrated from the beginning. He's made a way for all of us to be with him. And none of us are on our own. None of us. That your problem is so small, but yet God cares for it. Not a sparrow can fall to the ground without him knowing. Not a hair is left unnumbered on your head. He cares for you so intimately well. And he will encourage your heart. He will bring joy to your heart. He will bring hope this season. I want to pray this morning for anybody who's been underneath a lie. Because so many of us have lived through discouragements. So many of us have had so many things hit our souls as discouragements to the promise. Some of us have held on to a promise for 40, 50 years that we haven't seen the fulfillment of yet. And God wants to give you hope that you can trust him, that he will bring breakthrough. It might not be the way you expect it, but he will bring breakthrough. He is the God of promise. So if you're dealing this morning with any lies that are impacting your hope over a given situation, I can't speak to that, but the Holy Spirit can. And so I want to invite any prayer ministers to come forward, and I want to ask you to be bold enough that if that's you, to come forward and get prayer this morning. Don't wait till, you know, things are in a major crisis. Just say, hey, you know what? I want to hope for this. Can we hope together? I want to have a joyful anticipation of good as the outcome and nothing less. Our God is the God of breakthrough. Let's pray. Father, I thank you that you are with us. I thank you that you are so good and so kind to put on human flesh, to come down and to become us. God, I thank you that though we don't know every problem and every solution, nothing surprises you. And that you hold in you all of the wisdom of treasures and knowledge and beauty that are all within you. And so God, even this morning, Lord Jesus, for every situation, for every crisis, for every area of weakness, every place of struggle that your people have been in this room, God, I ask you that you would set our eyes on things above. God, not that we would forget the problem, but Lord Jesus, that that problem would not hold a spot, a position in between us and you. God, Romans 8 even goes on and talks about that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor demons, nor powers, nor things present, nor the future, nor the past, nothing can separate us from the love of God. So God, I pray, Lord Jesus, that every obstacle, everything that would hold us back and keep us from loving you with all of our heart, mind, and soul and strength, any obstacle that would keep us from having full expectant hope in you, Lord Jesus, it would come to nothing and those things would crumble. We take authority over every lie spoken by the enemy, every discouragement in Jesus' name. And we declare there is hope and there is light in this season, a light in the darkness. That our God is the God of breakthrough. He is the God of promise. And in him, all of his promises are yes and amen. So, Lord, we trust you. We love you. Help us, Lord. Come and help our unbelief. Lord, we believe it, but come and help our unbelief. Lord, we believe you. We believe your word. We believe what you said is true. But come and help our unbelief. God, come be the God of breakthrough. Come be the God of promise. For situations where parents are crying out for answers for their children, God, would you be the God of promise? Would you be the God of breakthrough? For situations where kids are struggling in their schools underneath the lies of the enemy, come and be their God of promise. Come be a God of breakthrough in the school. God, for those that are struggling underneath the weight of depression and anxiety, come and be their God of promise. Now, Lord, would you come and help us? I pray for every person here that they would be blessed as we go into this Advent season, that we would be filled with all joy, knowing that you, O God, are the answer. And God, we put our eyes and our trust in you. We put our eyes on you. We climb up in your lap like a good daddy you are. And we say, God, we love you and we trust you. More than Santa Claus. We want our heart to connect with your heart this season. Come and give your people joy. Overcome everything else. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. God bless you.
Promises are yes and amen.